Thank you, Joe. Yeah, thank you everyone for coming to join me in this park, because just before we started, John was asking me that, you know, it's pretty neat now to be a messenger of peace, to get to deliver this message as a full-time job, so to speak, and it's really, really nice. And I said I almost feel like that, like a full-time messenger or full-time channel, but the only difference, I guess, is all for me. So that actually makes it very simple. Like, I just want to focus on that, whatever is going on that is for an experience that I can tap into now, you know, it's not like anything that I strive for the future or anything that I need other people to get or to bring along. So this constantly become invitation in this moment, and everybody can join me. And that's really the purpose of today as well. And I have David Hoffmeister join me again. Thank you so much for...
Oh, it's great. It's great to be here.
Yeah. And I know this is all for an experience, just for us to be together like this, like, this is it.
Yeah, it's beautiful. Beautiful park and sugar house and blankets laid out, chairs, Jerry's all relaxed with her feet propped up. A little creek flowing gently by us. It's a beautiful
mountains
behind us. Amazing.
Yeah. That's Jessica coming.
Ah. Another recent Salt Lake City resident. Jessica Rary, let's have a hit. With this. Here she comes. It's interesting too, when we were just sitting here too, it's like I just had this thought that dropped in my mind that from the Course in Miracles, where Jesus is saying that, you know, Christ is an idea in the mind of God, and he's saying that you have great difficulty. It's very challenging to think of yourself as an idea, because the whole part of separation and the whole part of the seeming fall from grace, or the idea of falling asleep and taking on a dream, is that it's really thinking in terms of concretes and specific. Even a body seems to be very concrete and specific. It seems not like an idea at all. We were never told by our parents when we were growing up that we were an idea in the mind of God. You know, that never came about. It was finish your spinach and eat your peas, and if you don't clean your plate, you get no dessert. But they weren't talking about that we were an idea in the mind of God. And I was just having a meditation this afternoon where I was thinking how wonderful to be told that, first of all, by Christ, that I am an idea in the mind of God. And then furthermore, to start to think of that this is a world of ideas. And that's something that we were never told either. That's the first time I heard that, was in A Course in Miracles, that this is a world of ideas. And then you go a little bit further, that all of these ideas that we call time and space, they're all equal. I mean, every single concept and every single thought that we think, as far as this world, is equally the same. Everything. Whether it's a snow cone or a world war, or whether it's intense rage or a little bit of irritation, or whether it's an ant or a tree or a mountain, they're all equally ideas. And that's really the realization it's going to take for us to come back to being an idea in the mind of God. First, we have to deal with what's in front of us in perception, and just to open your mind to that idea that everything is equally an idea, that this is a world of ideas. You really have to forgive spirituality to do that, because spirituality, a lot of spiritual teachings will teach you there's thoughts, and then there's the manifest world, that there's a difference between the thoughts that you think and the world that you think you see, and that it's there are invisible things and there are visible things, and that the visible things, you know, the images are very different from the invisible things. There's a big difference between the visible and the invisible. Like I could just throw out an idea or a concept of a pink donkey, okay? Sounds like something out of more of an animation or something. What's that one where they have all the animals, Madagascar, all the different amazing animals. But okay, we'll show out the idea of a pink donkey. Now people could say, well, there really aren't pink donkeys, but if we open up to the idea that everything is equally an idea, then pink donkey is just as the same as gray donkey or pink elephant or anything else. It's just a convincing, but it really can't be that hard to give yourself over to the way things actually are, that everything is an idea. Nothing's really projected, because projection is not an attribute of God. You know, God doesn't project. So if God doesn't project, it can't be real. So we have to let go of this idea that somehow there are levels and there are degrees and gradations, and that everything is more than a world of ideas. And I absolutely enjoy the experience of the world being a world of ideas, because there's nothing to protect, there's nothing to defend, you don't have to stand up for something or protect something or deny something. It's just simply an awareness that this is a world of ideas. It's great. I mean, that's the message that we're sharing. And that's why there's no problems. If this is a world of ideas and they're all equally unreal, then how could there be a problem out of that? If that's the soup that you're dealing with, so to speak, then you don't have a problem. Is it practical? I think it's the most practical to start to see the world as a world of ideas. Walt Disney made up a lot of characters and a lot of things we call animation, talking animals and dancing animals and dancing broomsticks and all kinds of things, but it can be entertaining, and it can even be more than entertaining. It can actually be peaceful if you just see that it's just a world of ideas. How could you have an argument if it's a world of ideas? It's when you think that some ideas are more important than others, or you're identified with some of the ideas and not with others, then that's where the difficulty comes in.
It's unthinkable. An idea can't think of itself as an idea. It's like that's why you can't think your way to reality or to truth. It is an effect. It is not something that can perceive itself. It almost like has to drop. It's not something, you know, even when we come together, it's not really about getting or acquiring or gaining any understanding. It's actually about dropping any understanding so that what you are talking about can be experienced. That's my experience, I think. I was talking to a friend a few days ago just about this transfer of training idea, because that is what I see as practicality, you know, to practice A Course in Miracles and eventually transfer it to everything and every idea, every thought, and have no exceptions. And the experience of that, in the end, was, I think I was asked particularly about you, like how I see you. And I remember my answer was, it actually really took me, you know, just this kind of practice really took me beyond to see a person as a person being right, more right than others. It's actually really lifted up to seeing the spirit behind it. And the experience of it was that I said I always can see, because it almost feels like a clear lake. I feel like I always can see the bottom. But as soon as I drop to where I thought was the bottom, it was deeper. And I keep dropping, and it's always deeper and deeper than I thought. And that's my experience living this way. Is I don't know how deep the rabbit hole is. It actually seems shallower than it actually is. Like, it's almost like you can grasp. You can always grasp, and you can always, if there's a temptation even to the egos wanting to see that it's gonna get there soon, and some kind of arrogance of, I know what this is about and I can get there very soon. But it's the very opposite in the experience is actually this constant humbling experience and opening up and then realizing, oh my God, I thought this is it. It's still, the floor keeps opening up and I keep dropping through the lake and do not know where the bottom is. And just that was my answer to a question of my experience with you, is this constant humbling experience and to see, you know, a guide like has walked through the practical steps and always think, I know now, I get it. But then when I get there, I was like, oh my God, that's the lake keeps getting deeper.
Yeah, it's nice. Yeah, it's nice when somebody even asks, like, what's your opinion? The first time that happened, it was like, oh, that's funny. It's a funny thought, what's your opinion? But then, or even when somebody says, share your thoughts and so forth, then, yeah, I guess it gets to be, it's just such an expansive experience and feeling that there may be something to speak or not. And but we're all, it seems like every talk we do, we come back to that involuntary nature, that there's nothing to figure out, whether to speak or not to speak. Actions seem involuntary. A friend of ours from Las Vegas contacted us, and she was pondering this whole involuntary thing. But you can just feel how relaxing it is to open up to just a couple ideas that I've shared. One is that everything is an idea, equally an idea, because you don't have to order them, you don't have to arrange them, you don't have to identify with them, you don't have to figure them out. There's nothing to analyze. If everything's equally an idea, then it takes away all conflict. And then the involuntary nature, so there's nothing really to explain. You're in an experience, you feel the connection, you feel the joy, but there's nothing that needs to be explained, because there aren't persons that need to be explained to. And in the end, you're not a person that has to explain yourself. That's ultimate freedom, is a state of acceptance where you see it's beyond the personal entirely, always has been. It never was something there. You don't have to justify actions. You don't have to justify inactions.
It's very freeing not to explain anything and justify anything, actually.
Because it's a state of guiltlessness. If you're innocent, then obviously there's nothing to justify one way or the other. But this also means that there's nothing to pursue. Because if this is just a world of ideas, then, and they're all equally the same thing, it just, talk about wiping everything out. Joe played a song and everyone was laid out, but that's really what forgiveness does. It's like it throws a blanket of peace over the whole world and says, no, there's nothing to get huff about, as the Beatles said. There's an ease with that. Everything, all is well in forgiveness. And that's because there's nothing to pursue, there's nothing to defend.
Yeah. We talked about, you know, swallow the red pill. Have we swallowed the red pill yet?
Like the Matrix metaphor.
Yeah, you have taken it, but it's in the mouth. Have you, you know, get it fully down there yet? But, you know, when we... the temptation is to think if we have done it, it's almost like, another thing to achieve. I'm going to go for it. But it's the total opposite. Really, when we... If we have swallowed... Is that swallow? Is it the word?
Mm-hmm. That's a word.
If we have swallowed the red pill, it's really, then you swept everything clean. Basically, that's really what's going on in the mind. You don't carry anything with you anymore from the past or achieve anything in the future. And that is the opposite of what the mind is thinking. It's like, okay, I'm going to go for the end of the rabbit hole. I'm going for it. But it's allowing yourself to drop, allowing yourself to be carried, and you yourself quit. That's like, you leave everything. You leave everything, you go with empty-handed and allow yourself to fall with the spirit every moment. That's what it means.
Yeah, let's just review that scene from The Matrix, because he goes to visit Morpheus, and Morpheus is wearing those sunglasses that are reflective. And you can see Neo in the sunglasses, and you can see that there's two pills, the red pill and the blue pill. But before taking the pill into his mouth and taking the glass of water, there's a glass of water there too to help the swallowing, Morpheus is the symbol of the Holy Spirit. Morpheus pauses and says, remember, it's a pause before he actually takes the red pill. Remember, all I'm offering you is the truth. So imagine that you go through this whole so-called spiritual journey and you think you read books and you listen to teachers and you go to seminars and workshops and you pray and you meditate, you do all this stuff seemingly as a human being. And then you get to one point where you've got to commit your whole life over to the Spirit without compromise. Unequivocally, you've got to do it. And that we'll say is taking the red pill. But right before you do it, the Spirit says, like in Morpheus, saying, remember, all I'm offering you is the truth. I'm not saying this will make your life better in the world. I'm not saying that it will make the world a better place. I'm not saying it will make the world a happy place. All I'm offering you is the truth. And there's a pause there, because in order to take the red pill, you've got to decide for it. And then when he actually does take the red pill, he puts it in his mouth and he takes a drink of water and he swallows it, then the whole scene shifts very quickly, where they move into another room away from the tall chairs and everything. And remember, that's the one where they start hooking things up to him. So immediately, as soon as he takes the red pill, everything starts to be set in motion for a very different kind of experience. And then you'll remember that's the scene where he's hooked up, and then all his, like, this kind of a mercury, this shiny, gooey liquid starts to come all over up his arms, and it's cold. So now he's gone into another room where it's just like mercury coming up, and then it comes all the way up, and it comes up all the way to the neck, and then it comes all the way to the first orifice that the mercury finds, which is his mouth. And it starts to come up around the neck, and it starts to go in, and that's almost like a symbol of dissolving of the personal self, because the mercury, the shiny, fluid mercury, is like the Spirit again. The Holy Spirit's like water in some cases, but this is like shiny mercury. And then when it starts to go in, it's like his whole personality, the whole person just kind of implodes, and that's when he drops down into the subconscious mind, where he's all plugged in. You know, he's gone from the surface Neo, or surface Neo to, Mr. Anderson, down into the unconscious mind. And he's still undoing. But that's, I think, that's really the point that you everyone has to come to, where they're willing to let go of everything that they think they know about the world, about themselves, about survival, about family, about community, about everything.
That's truly what leaving the world behind is. It's actually, you know, last time we talked about seemingly leaving the tangible things and a job. That is like the beginning. If you believe you're compromising, then that could be, you know, something to opening up and as a starting of not compromising this inspiration and happiness anymore. But in the end, leaving the world behind is leaving everything, like my drive towards anything in the world, you know, every kind of past associations, what I think I am and what I think I know about relationships, about friendships, about career, security, health, everything needs to be left behind. It's in the mind.
Yeah.
That's been left behind. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, even something like loyalty. I mean, when I was being raised, you know, loyalty was a very important thing. You know, you trust, you have loyalty, you keep the faith, and so on and so forth. And then, but loyalty is still at the level of interpersonal, the way it's talked about in the world. But in the end, can one be loyal to peace of mind? Can you be willing to when all the concepts are getting washed away, instead, even loyalty, even personal loyalty, and some of the things, the noble things of the world, those are starting to get rinsed as well.
Mm.
You know, you really have to let go of everything, because everything that's aimed at persons is getting rinsed away, even personal loyalty. Loyalty to a spouse, to a teacher, you know, to a friend. Those things are the things that movies are made of, you know. And then in the end, you know, there's a disillusionment with all that, and then it's just finally an experience that comes that is completely unlike the human condition.
Right. It is very practical if we really, you know, talk about even the practicalities. Actually practical to leave everything, you know, behind and, you know, come to this blank slate every moment. Just be willing to drop that. You know, everything can be used for us to see where the hooks are and to see what has been brought to this moment from the past or try to achieve in the future. You know, it's actually not that hard to have these kind of realizations.
Yeah. Yeah. So I think it's, you can see why it has no ambition in it, because it's just so focused in the present. There's not a shred of ambition to make something happen.
Mm-hmm.
And that's also the relaxation with it. It's like the gateway is let your yes be yes, your no be no, and then there comes a point when yeah, everything falls away, even the yeses and the noes. But to trust that unwinding, to reach that point of serenity, of acceptance, just taking your moment by moment flow, like you're saying, going deeper down the rabbit hole, however it feels, just giving yourself fully over to that, with no attempt to control anything or direct anything. In the end, linear time is the grievance that has to be forgiven. It's not so much with persons. That's just the trick to kind of keep the guilt in place, but yeah. You can feel it when your mind just is letting go more and more and more, just sinking deeper and deeper inward.
Mm-hmm. How many of us have seen that linear time is a grievance? Like, you have seen it? You have seen it? That's great. You can see linear time is a grievance. It's not even specifics between people. let alone is the person in and of itself, is linear time.
Yeah, I love the line in the Course, beware of the temptation to perceive yourself unfairly treated. Imagine that you could see the world in a way in which you see that there's never been a mistreatment ever. Of course, that would wipe out history. But that you that they're not only that they had been corrected, but that there never was. It reminds me of us, we were just in Sugar House, was it a couple days ago, we were guided to go see X-Men and Days of Future Past, you know. I had to laugh when I first saw that title because I used to talk about that for years. The past past and the future past, and they're both equally unreal. But it's beautiful because there's an awareness that a grievance has to be released, and nobody knows how it's going to happen. And when it finally comes down to the scene of the release, I think it's more so not the Mystique character dropping her weapon, but it's more so that Charles says, I've always tried to control you. He realizes he can't control Mystique and nor anyone else. You know, he's been a helper, but there's been an aspect of control there. And when he says, I've always tried to control her, because there's somebody saying, make her, freeze her mind, or, you know, as if he has the power in his mind to do something to her to save the day. And he won't exercise that option. Mm. He lets go, he surrenders.
Yeah, I love that, because she was trying. It's a little like butterfly effect. Like in this realm, like she was trying, or they were trying different ways to stop her, but they could try whatever they want. It's still gonna play out. Like they could stop her, but then something else would happen to make it happen as well. You know, nothing could really eventually stop the war or the grievance or the inevitable outcome except the forgiveness. That's the only way that they completely drop the whole seemingly impossible scenario there, is when seemingly she chose to forgive, but he saw his control of her, and when that dropped. And I love it because we have seen that movie many times. We were just guided to see that again. And I noticed you actually drifted off a little bit during the movie, and I did that too. And when I woke up, you woke up and turned to me. That was the very scene. You said, this is the revelatory scene. Yeah. And I was like, yeah. And we were just went there for that very scene, actually.
We paid our $1.50 to go in
there.
We were
both
for big spenders. We spent $1.50 for one scene, and then we both are like. And when the scene came, I'm like, oh. It was so great. But what's so great about that scene, he gave up the control, she dropped the gun, and then the seeming future scenario just vanished. So it's like a hypothetical destruction scene from the future that really, it's not like it's the forgiveness stopped the scene or saved the day or stopped the bad ones or whatever, all that, like the typical things. It just, the whole scene was gone and never was, you know. And that, to me, that's what forgiveness is. It's when you think of your life in linear terms, and like if you'll somehow make the right moves and do the right things and say the right things, it's not really that. It's just all hypotheticals. And when you finally forgive, you give up the control, you come to accept the atonement, acceptance, then you see that it never was. So for all of you that have had trouble healing relationships, the problem is you're trying to heal something that you think really happened. That's the problem. That's how deep it goes, you know. Like Jesus says in the Course, forgive your brother for what he did not do. Well, the only way you can forgive your brother or sister for what they did not do is if it was just a figment of imagination. Did you notice when some of you came in the park today that was in flowers? That was what was written out. Imagine there. Now we're kind of coming into the park here to say, okay, how can we relax beyond, even beyond imagine? Yeah. That's it. We've enjoyed the movies, but now they're kind of running out too. Everything's running out. Yeah, this movie festival we're doing in September, that better come to it, because we might be going beyond movies soon, you know, as much as we've enjoyed them, the spirit's use of them.
Yeah, this is how deep it goes, like, but we start with the leaves, and that's where the perception level is. I remember, I can't remember which interview or something last few days, this guy was saying that he had this attraction to this girl, but he did something really embarrassing. I can't remember the details, but he did something really embarrassing that just unbearable to himself, that he did that to the girl. So he will, and the girl wasn't aware of it completely. So he, from that point on, for years and years, he just avoided seeing her. And when the topic came up from friends, and he will attack her. But all of this attack and grievance and anger towards her, she was not aware of it, has nothing to do with her, was all started from seemingly this experience of he did something really embarrassing. And he couldn't bear to remember that event. So just like her existence was almost like a memory or a trigger of this deeper grievance or this guilt that came up. But that is at the surface level. You know, that's where we can start to see, even to forgive the other person, let go of the other person, because you can just get caught in how I don't like the other person and how, you know, that is just not the case at all. And then when you go, his grievance, he did something embarrassing, that is not it either. You know, just, but that is opening up to a possibility to go deeper. Eventually, it will open up to leader time. That's what it really is about, not an action that is embarrassing. What come up as a guilt is not because of an action or because of anything, it's all coming back. But that's what really the process is about, is that we do not deny the specific, because that's a great entry point. And to use that to really drop deeper, and if without forgiveness, this dropping process will not be able to happen. So the whole thing is to, you know, with every single specifics is to say, you know, to Jesus or Spirit, hold my hands so that I have the courage to drop further to see what is really underneath this. That's the wind. that's my favorite prayer, is to, you know, have this picture that I'm holding Jesus' hand to come to a place that maybe at this point I'm not even have the courage to see, you know. So it's not about even figure out a specifics, but it's really about how can I let this specifics go so I have the courage to drop deeper to what's really, really, really is the source of this grievance. So every time I think about that, I feel grateful for this process, you know, just knowing that the specifics in everyday life that we can see, you know, just staying there can never really heal anything, really. Yeah.
Yeah, it's beautiful just to be able to stop and realize that's not it. And then you don't put your attention into pursuing, trying to solve the problem where there is no problem. Now the wind got very still for us. That's good. Well, we have a live audience here.
I
Anybody want to inquire about something? Since we're on the mics, we'll repeat whatever you've got that you'd like to share. Comment, question, inquiry. Jerry. Yeah, Jerry's asking if everything's an idea, are all these ideas to be let go of? I think from the ego's perspective, it looks like a let go. From the spirit's perspective, it's more of an integration, like more of an acceptance of like, oh, these are all equally in my mind. So it's not so much a letting go, it's more of an embrace. Like it's a big embrace, like, oh, these are all ideas in my mind.
That concepts.
Yep. Yep. And that embrace, we'll call that forgiveness. That's still a concept too, because in heaven, there's nothing to forgive. So even forgiveness must be a concept. But it's like an all-embracing, all-encompassing concept. And how is that practical? Well, I did a show, I think, with Francis very recently, maybe a couple days ago, and I've done some shows recently where I would say, it doesn't matter to me what people believe anymore, whether they believe in God or they don't believe in God. You know, that seems to be a pretty big distinction as the world would see it. Believers and unbelievers, you know, ooh, you know, you want to be on the right fence there with that one, believers or unbelievers. But I was seeing that really people are just ideas. So all people are just concepts as well. And they're equally concepts. So there's not better people or worse people or right people or wrong people. You know, you really have to see that in the end, in terms of the world, right and wrong, morality, that's deep when you start to say, oh, those are a bunch of concepts as well. But this embracing concept of forgiveness, which sees that they're all the same, to me, that's where the peace of mind is. So it doesn't have to be seen as a letting go, because it could be like, as a person, what do I have to let go? And that's still the assumption that you're starting with being a person, and you've somehow got to let go of these concepts that are like whirling around in there. But in the end, even letting go of the person, mm-hmm. seeing that's just another concept as well. Yeah, I think, yeah, it's the embrace is, from the ego perspective, it can seem like a letting go, because it thought it had it in the first place. From the higher perspective, you can't really let go of what you never had. And so it's more of an opening to the real world or the happy dream of just seeing that everything's an idea. So it's not really a letting go, it's more of an opening to an appreciation of what is, in the sense that the Course tells us that the Holy Spirit answered the separation as soon as it happened, simultaneously. So we're really just accepting that correction. It's not really an action thing. It's not really that a person ever goes, oh, I've done it. And even when we look at history and we say, well, Jesus did it, now we've got to deal with the rest of us. You know, he says, when I awoke, you were with me. Kind of implying, oh no, when I accepted this embrace, everyone was with me. And we're all home in this embrace. So isn't that a relief? You don't even have something to let go of. You don't have to. It gets easier and easier. It's more of just seeing that you're just opening to an acceptance. An acceptance. That's why in the Course it says, accept the sole responsibility of the miracle worker or the teacher of God is to accept the atonement for himself. Accept. I like that. It's already there. It's not, you don't have to come up with it. You don't have to come up with it and say, is this good enough? Is this, do I get back? Can I come back home? You know, it's not, you don't have to keep, is it? You don't have to come up with this process of hoping that you've come up with something good enough, you know. Yeah, that's lesson 189. that simply do this, be still, and then it goes on, lay aside all thoughts of what you are, what God is, hold on to nothing, do not bring with you one thought the past is taught, nor one belief you learned before from anything. Forget this world, forget this course, and come with open arms unto your God. From the ego's perspective, remember, the course is written for the ego, or for the, even more specifically, for the mind that believes in the ego. Because that mind is going to have to make a choice for another way. But it's got to come in egoic terms, because when the mind believes in the ego, everything it perceives, including the book, A Course in Miracles, is perceived through that filter of separation. It seems to be a separate book. It seems to be a blue book with gold letters. Somebody just sent me a purple book with gold letters. It's called A Course of Love. So now I've got two books there in my room. See, purple and blue, gold. But still, it's perceived through the filter as if they're separate books and separate words. But ultimately, I would say that's just practical for the mind that's waking up, is to describe it from a letting go perspective. You know, it's the same thing we, you know, give up something for Lent, or, you know, in Christian terms, you have to give up things. And mystics and saints had to give up things, and we even talked about give up the world. But I'm saying from a higher perspective, it does dawn in your mind that it's more just an embrace or an integration. Because most of us know that integrating and wholeness sound good. We may not know how that happens or what that really is, but integration and wholeness has a good ring, a good resonance to us. And that's actually, from the Holy Spirit's perspective, everything's just coming whole, because it's already whole. It's just wholeness is coming into awareness. Integration is coming into awareness. Integrity is coming into awareness. And that's more of a sense of embrace or coming together than it is, I've got to peel the onion. Just keep throwing off as many onion peels and layers as I can. That's certainly how it seems as you're going through the process. So that's why it's in there that way. It's just to be practical. You're welcome. Oh, you all look so relaxed out there. It's even more relaxed than in a studio, in a garage, is out there on the grass, on the blankets. It's very relaxing. It's great seeing you again, John. You look so relaxed. Your sunglasses on, just kicking back. It's beautiful. It's beautiful. This is the way to have a Friday afternoon, laid out in the grass with your friends.
That's it. Time just flew by. It's already 5. So.
It's a great way to practice peace.
Isn't it? This is really what this is all about, just to be together and job together. This is like an excuse. The show is an excuse so that we go come out and be together.
It is. It's a great excuse, a backdrop, just to be together. No expectations. Isn't it nice just to be together without an agenda, without an expectation? Mm. How freeing that is. I mean, it's got to be the height of relationship just to be in a state of beingness, acceptance, and embrace. This itself is an embrace.
Yeah. It's like there is no future, there is no next moment, and just for now, just for now that we can be in this together.
Ego has its own version of early retirement, and the Holy Spirit has a version of holy retirement. The Holy Spirit's version is one of acceptance of everything right here, right now. And then the ego's is very much, again, on the timeline. Work hard, maybe have to do things you don't want to do, maybe have to do a lot of things that you don't want to do, but save your money, invest your money, have your nest egg, and then retire and have a pension or a retirement fund or something that will sustain you. And then, you know, it will throw things in like, well, you know, sometimes pensions get raided or get squandered, or, you know, it just will say, well, yeah, you know that there's nothing for sure in this world. But, yeah, just forget, put that aside for a while and stick to the formula and, you know, try to use the formula. But basically, I think I had to see that following the Holy Spirit was a purpose. And literally, I felt like I could feel emotionally and experientially like that was an early retirement. Because I was not working for a boss in linear time anymore, just that comfortable, small, still voice that I could connect with at any time. Then that was, at the time, that was the way I saw it. Now it's more like a merge, like, you know, it's, there's nothing, yeah, nothing to get huff about. There is no, you know, buying into the formula in any way. It was always about an acceptance. And some of you have been following the news, like with Robin Williams recently with the suicide, and then it came out, you know, just recently too, more details that it was like he'd been diagnosed with Parkinson's. And some of you know, like what Michael J. Fox and different ones that have gone through that are kind of celebrities in the public eye. And it's, again, it's just a self-concept, but Robin wanted to bring laughter to the world. He wanted to bring joy and inspiration. He didn't want to bring frailty, weakness, concern. You know, Parkinson's is so associated with it being a debilitating kind of disease where you lose control of faculties. Here we are in spiritual terms, we're saying, lose control, lose control. But to the ego, it's the worst thing, especially if you see yourself as a bringer of laughter and funny, active, supporting children, supporting people all over the planet, you know, with your roles, with your movies and everything. So it's kind of came down to a sense of, do I have to let go of the role that I'm accustomed to, that I want to offer as a gift, or do I have to, you know, move into something that seems very scary, like loss of control, even control over the body? You know, that can seem very scary. And in those terms, the suicide can even, you know, that's how it goes in the mind. The suicide can look more like an out. Like, I can't stand to be in the public eye in kind of a diseased, falling apart way. I would rather take a bow, you know, like the Truman Show, good afternoon, good evening, good night, and stop while I'm ahead. But what we're learning is, you know, it's not really a letting go of control, because we never really had it in the first place. God didn't really create us to be controlling the world, controlling bodies, having even control over motor control. You know, that's accepted as part of the dream, but it's really still another aspect of what never was. It's just starting to realize that's humbleness, to start to realize, no, everything that I thought I was, I wasn't. And they were talking about all of his, you know, movies, Mrs. Doubtfire and Good Morning Vietnam and all these movies, but they said the one that most fans identified with and found most comfort with was the one with Annabelle Scorsese and with the paintings. Yeah, what dreams may come. And that was about a suicide, actually, if you remember Annabelle. You know, and he played the comforting character, that his wife was tormented with suicide at the thought of losing her husband. And he, you know, Cuba Gooding Jr. was played like this character. It all turned out that it was a world of ideas. And he was told by Cuba Gooding Jr., you know, you can have it be however you want to be. The sky, it was all like a painting. It was a beautiful movie. But I think of all the movies that we were aware of, that's one of our Movie Watcher's Guide to Enlightenment that just touched a lot of us, because it was a transcendent movie about facing and going beyond suicide, beyond the belief in suicide, that there was something there beyond it, that death wasn't the end. And it's how appropriate, you know, really with the way things played out with Robin, it just gave everybody a chance to go, oh yeah, let's come back to that movie of transcendence. You know, that was it of all the movies. That was forgiveness, it was transcendence, it was, there's more. Don't lose hope. Don't think that death is the end. Yeah. And in that movie, you might remember, even though he found that tracker and that guide, and he had his helpers along the way that turned out to be his children even helping him, but it was like that he had to go into hell to try to rescue his wife. But the Course is so good, it's teaching us you can't bring the truth into the illusion. You just have to see the illusion for what it is. You have to see the illusion of hell. And you have to bring the illusions to the truth of who you are. So that's what we're doing. You know, that's why we have a way shower who showed us it won't work to bring the truth into the illusion. Keep questioning your illusion. Keep raising up the unconscious beliefs. Keep raising up the darkness to the light and see that the darkness will disappear. That's the way that the way shower has given us. And that's the way that I took. You know, whenever it came down to me having a thought, those people aren't getting it. When will the world change? When will this happen? Jesus is like, come on, would you quit singing that tune? We're not going to bring the light into the darkness. We're not going to ever bring the truth into the illusion. You're never even asked to take the light into hell. Like your brothers are in hell and you're going to have to go deliver, be the great messenger deliverer. Jesus is like, no way. Just start to see that everything that you perceive was made up by the ego, and you don't have to identify with any of those thoughts, and you're free. And so I like that the way is clear. You know, we don't have to hesitate. We just have to apply it, you know. We have to apply it.
We have to apply it.
Yeah. What do we need? A way shower and the instructions, apply it. As best you can, try not to make exceptions to the lessons. Well, that's pretty simple. Give me the lessons, give me the instructions, and just say, now do it. Or undo it. So we did it again.
Out of the blue.
Out of the blue.
Comes Francis Zhu.
Francis
Zhu. It's weird to say my own name.
The show is so effective, it's becoming weird to complete the title. But you like out of the blue.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, everybody. Thank you for joining us.
Yeah, thank you.
Next to you here.